Hey everyone, this is Around the Farm, the podcast about all things ag. I'm your host, Clint Schaffer, and on today's episode, we're going to be talking to Dan Meyer of Farmers Mutual Hail and talking about all things insurance. Stay tuned. Dan, thanks for joining us here today on Around the Farm. How about you give a little introduction to the listeners there?
Okay, yep. I am a farmer slash crop adjuster here in southeast Nebraska. We're corn and soybeans row crop. We did get out of the cattle business a couple years back, but so we're just focused on corn and soybeans. We did intertwine irrigation into the mix last year. So there is some non-irrigation and irrigation right in our area that we do.
Nice. Well, I got to ask, you know, I mean, since we're pretty much post-harvest here, how'd the crops turn out for you?
You know, we were pretty pleased with the crops in our area. I'd say we're in the range of 10 to 20% above APHs.
Wow.
Except we had some localized hail and wind events. Those were drastically lower. But other than that, we get away from those storms. Yeah, we were very pleased.
Well, I mean, that's a perfect segue. The only thing, you know, wind and hail is good for is for a good segue into this conversation right here, which is talking about insurance. You're also a claims adjuster, right?
Yes. I started back in 2009 with Farmers Mutual Hail, working part-time adjuster, and now I've gone into full-time with them. So it's been a great experience, and yeah, I really enjoy it.
Now, how big of a area do you cover, Dan?
Well, you know, southeast Nebraska. I tell people maybe south of I-80 to the Kansas line, and west to probably, Jefferson, Thayer County there, west of Beatrice, Fairbury. That's my main territory, but I do help out with other adjusters when needed.
Yep. Now, across that, I would assume that, you know, I mean, that's a pretty good sizable area. I would assume a lot of different events happen throughout the season through there. What kind of claims do you end up seeing across your territory?
Any given year, we're going to have some hail, some wind, some drought, or possibly some excess moisture from year to year. It just kind of varies. Usually with excess moisture is where my replants and prevent plant claims come in. Yep. More common, it seems like, every year is a drought. There's somewhere's dry. That comes to production claims. And there's always one or two hail events or wind events that come through.
I would assume in there you'd also have maybe a little river bottom area throughout there as well.
Yes, there is some there on the Missouri River right there where Iowa and Nebraska meet. We do have a little bit there. Yep.
I know we farm up against the Mississippi, and that's probably one of our main things, right? When you start looking at excess moisture is a beast to contend with, that's for sure.
That's right.
Well, looking at this past year, I mean, for 21, what was some of the primary claims that that you've seen in your area?
Well, I'd say this year, hail and wind were kind of a big thing. Nothing like Iowa saw was that last year or 2 years ago, but we were kind of localized hail and wind events. My western counties, I'm going to have some pretty significant drought losses, but I'm just on the edge of the drought out there. Majority of my territory probably had plenty of moisture, so should be good. But I think the majority of my claims would be hail and wind this year.
Now, you mentioned, you know, irrigation too, Dan. I mean, are you getting into the irrigation territory within Nebraska then as well?
My little area that we're in is, it's hit and miss whether you find a good well or not. We just happened to on one of our farms, and so we're testing the waters, I guess, with it. And we've had a wind event last year with it and a bad hail event this year with it. So it has not panned out yet.
Well, to make you feel better, we have one irrigation system on our farm, and it was put up in 1993. And if you remember 93, that was one of the worst floods on the Mississippi there. And we didn't even have the ability to move it around the field that first year because we had a 30-acre pond that was out in the middle of it. It actually got stuck. So it was a wonderful year to put up a irrigation system on a major flood event. So,
yeah.
But, well, hey, you know, when we're talking about, you know, making these claims, what goes into it? I mean, I understand that a lot of this is covered and it is really alleviating the risk of the farmer, but what actually are some of the steps that a farmer has to make to really make a claim?
So the hail and wind, it's just basically call your agent. Let us know about it. Hail losses, we wait 10 days. We got to see what the crop's going to do afterwards. Wind, kind of the same deal. We wait a little bit, give it some time. Then we'll come out and do the adjustment process. With production claims, you know, with a traditional claim, if we're not talking precision, there's quite a lot that goes into it. We got to either have bin markings, we got to have load logs, we got to have summary sheets marked. Every ticket's got to be accounted for on a summary sheet. So when a farmer throws his tickets on his dash of his truck and writes the field name on it and one or two blow out the window, that can kind of get interesting to that part. So, but when we're talking precision, that really simplifies the process. Then we just need the seeding maps, the wet weight harvest map, and a calibration log showing the combine was calibrated within 3%.
So, I mean, when you're talking about precision data, if that yield data is coming in, there's no need for trying to figure out how much is in a grain bin or things of that nature at that point.
No, not for the claims process, unless something were to go wrong with the precision data for some reason. I always kind of tell guys, I'd still mark tickets. I'd still get an idea of what goes into things. If the precision, something would happen to go wrong, I don't see it very often at all. But if something would happen to go wrong, we go back to traditional methods working the claim. So it really simplifies the process when we do precision.
Speaking of that simplification, Dan, I mean, it also sounds, I mean, there's a huge time savings on this as well. What would you, you know, compare and contrast a traditional claim versus a claim with precision data? What's the time that's you know, kind of put into that?
Well, yeah. Okay. So for example, I've got a insured in my area that pretty sizable farmer for the area. He farms in four separate counties. He probably has 15 to 20 grain bins. Lot goes to town, so we gather summary sheets. He did have, before he started using precision, he still had the combine monitor. We used that for a load log at that point. So, I mean, it was, by the time I measured all the bins, the time he would spend marking summary sheets up for me, writing his load log out for me, we probably had 3 to 4 days wrapped up in that one claim. Now that he went to precision, he's got the Climate FieldView in his operation. And so he goes into FMH policy holder. He just clicks on his FieldView data, pulls it right in. It's in my hands. And then these precision claims I like to do in the evenings when I'm home. I've got all the information I need. Once the kids are to bed, I pull up that data. 1 to 2 hours, I can have that operation done. And he is actually one that's irrigated, non-irrigated. So it will split that out as well for us. He doesn't have to provide records for that. So it really speeds up the process and gets him his check a lot faster.
You're talking from days to hours.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it can, depending on the size of the operation, I mean, if we were talking a smaller farmer that would have had 5 bins to measure and then went to precision, I probably could work his in about 15 to 20 minutes. I mean, wow. It really helps the process. Yep.
Yeah. I would also assume that it saves you from driving as much as well then at that point.
Well, I still got to go out for signatures. I still meet with the farmers and make sure everything, I give them a copy and make sure everything comes out to where it needs to be, that they're okay with everything. But yeah, it's usually a one drive trip just for the signature.
Maybe I should have said less climbing grain bins then.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
What have you seen, you know, with the farmers that you work with? Has there been, you know, are they excited for this kind of transition? Is there any pushback to it? What's kind of been the uptake that you've seen just in your territory?
You know, I would say for the most part, usually when I come to a farm and if I notice they've got the globes or I see the monitors, I'll start asking them about it. It seems some kind of resisted a little bit. Don't know if they really want to trust that. I think the big thing that I've heard is they don't want something to go wrong in the process of the using precision, and it throws them out of getting a claim payment. And that's not the case at all. Like I said, we just revert back to traditional methods. We use the monitors as load logs, and we go back to claiming bins and filling out summary sheets. So it's not a waste of time. I try to encourage guys, give it a shot. You'd be amazed at how much it simplifies things.
Yeah, I mean, it also sounds too, you know, not only with the simplification, but I mean, it sounds like you get another, of course, you get another source of record, right?
Right.
On there as well, which I feel probably puts you in a better position to make sure you do get your claim paid out.
Yeah, absolutely. And another big push with this precision is, you know, a lot of guys are using the acres that they certify with FSA. A lot of times those are high. Those are, 5-10% high, probably, in some cases. When we're doing precision, we use your seeding maps. If you've got the row shutoffs, that's going to be more accurate acre count than using 578s from the FSA. So we're taking the same amount of bushels off a farm at harvest time and dividing it by less acres, creating a higher APH.
Yep.
So we're just building guys' APHs. There's so many benefits to using precision in the crop insurance industry.
And so I mean, that's really truly using actual planted acres at that point in time, not just the field boundary. It's wherever your planter went across, that's the acres that are in that field then.
Yep, absolutely.
Nice. Yep. And I mean, you talked about being compatible with FieldView, which I know that opens up to, you know, a ton of compatibility for equipment-wise. What's been the thoughts across the landscape of just having compatibility with all their different machines?
You know, it's FieldView has been a big. It's really growing, I think, in our area because of that. I mean, we've got John Deere machines, we've got Case, we got some Gleaner combines out here, and that FieldView, it's linking up with all their monitors. So it really, and then when they can go into FMH's policyholder center and they can just go right in, click on their FieldView data and bring it right into us. It really, really speeds up the process and makes things easier on guys.
Well, I know, you know, user friendliness is always a thing that we always hear, right? And it sounds like you put a lot of focus into making sure that you have that user friendliness, not only from a personnel standpoint, but also from that digital landscape as well. I know if I jump into somebody's portal and it's easy to use, it just makes the process so much better.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It won't scare the farmer away once they look at that field view and they realize that they can actually run it, and it's pretty easy to do. So, yep.
Well, I know we've been we've had about three different wind events on our farm now this year, and I think we had close to four last year. And so we had, you know, a couple fields that were impacted, you know, pretty heavy with some green snap and things of that nature. And I know that Dad was just talking the other day of starting to research, you know, wind insurance, right?
And
have you seen with some of these events, it seems like we've had a lot of wind events over the last couple of years. Have you seen an uptick in farmers getting wind coverage?
Absolutely. I would say in my territory 3 years ago, I probably only had a handful of claims. They're just because we only had a handful of insurers that took out the wind coverage. This year, there was a lot more policyholders that carry the wind insurance, and I believe next year will be even more because the wind event that went through here, a lot of guys did not have the coverage. So I do believe that will drive the number of people that take the wind insurance next year.
Now, has this impacted on the hail side of it, of guys jumping in and getting hail coverage?
Yeah, they're buying the hail coverage as well. Yep. And then they buy the wind on top of that hail policy. Yeah.
You know, I guess from my perspective, I look at insurance the same way that I look at, you know, seed treatment and fungicide and things of that nature, right? Which is all trying to protect your bottom line. You're trying to maximize your profits. And I think that having that coverage is a not only a peace of mind, but just a good business, you know, decision as well.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yep.
Well, hey, we are, you know, Thanksgiving was just a few days ago. We're rolling into the Christmas and New Year's area here. What are some of the things that you look forward to going into this holiday season?
Well, I guess I'd probably have to answer with seeing family, whether that is or not. But, you know, it's a break from climbing bins, I guess. That's a that's a big push for me. A couple days off there of climbing bins in the cold. But yeah, it's always nice to see family that we only see, seems like, at holidays.
Yeah. Now I couldn't agree more. Now what about, you know, favorite holiday dish? What's that, that one dish that you're just looking forward to that, you know, maybe a family member is going to bring? What is that?
Gosh, that's a hard one. Boy, I don't know. That's might have to be the green bean casserole or any kind of fruit pie. I always like pie too.
Yeah, that would probably be mine. So I am a huge pie guy, and my mother-in-law always brings pies, and that's always one of my favorite parts there. So
yeah, absolutely. Yep.
Well, Dan, I just want to say thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to come talk to me here on Around the Farm. This has been a great conversation. Excited about this continued connection between FMH and Climate FieldView. I think this has just been a huge benefit to our customers here.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me, Clint.
All right. Well, hey, you have a great holiday season. Take care.
You too. Thank you.
Hey, another thanks to Dan for joining us on today's episode. And also, thank you to you, the listeners out there. And if you enjoyed this episode, be sure to like the podcast, subscribe, and ring the bell to get notified each and every time that we push out new episodes. Also, Around the Farm is sponsored by Climate FieldView. So with that, we'll see you around the farm. Also, thank you to your... Blah, blah, blah.